morning. We want to encourage you to be here for that. The ministry of angels will be the topic of talk here in the main sanctuary. We also have our Thursday Bible study, Kings and Prophets, led by Minister Kathy Richardson. So come on out and be a part of that. You're invited to prayer.
I'm going to lift you up higher and higher. So I stop by to tell you, I stop by to say, somebody here, is there anybody here? Is there anybody that know what the Lord is doing in your life?
Come on, give him some praise. Worship your God. Worship your daddy. He's awesome. He has more than enough.
I can't be a drunk on a corner with a paper bag talking about being a millionaire. I'm lying. If I want to be a millionaire, I got to seek me out some millionaires, hang around the millionaire, and mimic what the millionaire do. If I want power from on high, I need to hang around people that got power. I need to hang around the anointing. I need to hang around those folks that are fasting, those folks that are praying. I need to hang around somebody who is filled. And if I hang around them long enough, good God, hallelujah, sooner or later, I'm going to get filled. Why? Because I'm going to mimic what they're doing. I'm going to follow what they're doing. I'm going to want to be what they are, and I will begin to change.
Monty D. Ware.
I'm Julius Harper. My name is Pastor Aaron B. Duncan, Sr.
Well, my name is Pastor Reggie Washington, Sr.
I'm the pastor, senior pastor of House of Prayer Ecclesiastic Ministries in Palmdale.
Santa Clarita Christian Fellowship, where I serve as the senior pastor.
It's Spirit and Truth Missionary Baptist Church.
The name of my church is Kingdom Ministries International.
We are associated with the Southern Baptist Convention. They were the organization that provided the key dollars for founding the church, which was founded by Pastor Robert T. Charles.
Being from the South, our church is formulated based on the blackness, and Baptist was white. And so that's where you get the term First Baptist, which was mostly the white churches, and a Second Baptist, which would be a black church. But I believe some of our forefathers began to go with the missionary Baptist. And at least that's how some of the stories get to me. And so down through the years, when I just happen to be missionary Baptist in most of my hometown.
The main challenge is people. Being in the people business is a rough, rough business.
The church is not a building. It's about people, which is true.
If without people, I tell everybody, when I go to an appreciation service for a pastor, and I hear a lot of pastors, when I used to listen to them, they would beat up on the people. I tell them, I'm not going to ever beat up on the people, because without people, you can't pastor. If you find yourself walking and no one behind you, you're probably just on a long walk, as my mother would say.
And I'm like, well, Paul was one of the greatest apostles we have, and he prayed a prayer to you, God. He asked you, he gave you a request, remove this thorn from my side. And you said, no, my grace is sufficient. I had a problem with God on that, but he gave me revelation, because in several passages in the Old Testament, God, the word reads that because you didn't remove the people from this land, because you didn't drive them out, there would be a thorn in your side.
I can tell you, being a pastor sometimes is a great job, except for the people. People problems, people challenges, people personalities, the managing of individuals can make the joy of being a pastor become overwhelmed sometimes.
But people are people. People are people. So I just don't want to say I have a low about it. If I was on the job, it would be still the same thing. So I don't really take it as low. But those maybe be some of the most difficult points, I'll put it like that. Not lows, but difficulties.
By both the expectations, the flakiness of people, the various personalities that you have to put up with. But I think ultimately you learn to balance and embrace that with the joys that come from being a pastor. And then also understanding what a pastor is. A pastor is a shepherd of people, and really specifically, a pastor is a shepherd of sheep. So once you kind of understand the dynamic, what sheep are like, what a shepherd does, and what a pastor does, it makes it not so difficult to embrace kind of the negatives of people that bite each other, fight with each other, have various expectations and so forth. But being a pastor comes with the challenges of people. That's the great part, but that's also the problematic part.
So if you're pastoring, you're gonna have people, and you say sheep, and you got to say, remember God has called us all, we are like sheep. And the study of sheep is to know that he has to be herded, for he does things not in the written. You know, he will not follow completely. Some straight, some stubborn, and of course you have some sicknesses. So that's what you're doing. So without people, there is no pastoring. So if you don't love people, get out of pastoring.
Well, so the greatest challenge that I believe I have, or any pastor, any preacher, any minister of the gospel will ever have, is the people.
Do I think it's important to know about other religions in order to teach about God? My answer to that would be absolutely not.
It is good to have taken a look at other religions and see the tenets of other religions, but I don't think you have to necessarily know about other religions.
I think it's important to know about other religions to teach about God, because you never know who's going to walk into your congregation, or you never know who you're going to meet.
But in essence, to know other religions and other doctrines and other things of that nature, it's good because it gives me insight into their thought process and what they believe, so that I can be a better effective witness for God to them. How to combat or deal with their thought process, or where they're coming from, how to get around their belief systems and what has been inbred in them throughout the years.
I believe that the truth of Jesus Christ stands completely on its own, and it doesn't need the backdrop of other religions to have kind of a comparative analysis.
If you have a base of where they are, then you can, what I say, build a bridge from the known to the unknown. So if I'm talking to a particular belief and I know something about it, I would tie into what they know and bring them over to what they don't know.
I take the approach that Paul took, Jesus Christ and him crucified. That's really the story.
Now, this is what Paul did on Mars Hill when the Greeks were very idolistic. They had every god represented in the Pantheon in their kingdom. But there was one, they did not have a statue, but just a stand in a plaque that said, to the unknown God. So Paul started with what they knew. Okay, there is an unknown God. And he brought them back over to what they did not know.
It is good for a pastor, because I've been asked, why not? Why this other religion is not as like Christianity? So in order to better base my answer, it is good to be informed about some of the tenets and what we believe in comparison to other religion, even if it's pantheism or monotheism, you know, which we are monotheistic, because we only believe in Jehovah God, one God, and we believe in him even though we believe in the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone, he doesn't shine in relation to other religions. His truth doesn't stand in relation to other religions. It stands completely on its own.
So I think it's very important for a preacher to know about other religions. He should know his craft, and he should know as much as he can, read many books. You don't have to agree with them all, but know them so that we can touch people where they are to bring them into where they need to be.
I think that it's a mistake. It provides more challenges and unnecessary dialogue to bring things into the picture when the truth of Christ stands on itself. What difference does it make what other people believe? What difference? I've got one particular Christ, born of a virgin, died and rose again. If nobody can come at me with something similar, Why should I waste my time talking about other religions when I maybe will have 5 or 10 minutes to speak truth into the life of another person? So from my own perspective, talking about other religions is not necessary nor important in terms of communicating the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ.
So knowing where they're coming from, then I can better deal with them. But I don't need to know what they know in order to teach the gospel, because it stands by itself.
Why does God allow these things to happen to, quote unquote, to good people? That's really the million-dollar question, okay? I can't tell you how many times that question has been asked. The answer simply is this. We're living within the context of a broken world. And I find that the question often comes up with people who are happy to have God stay out of their life, just only come around when something goes wrong.
Why does God allow good people to die? There's many reasons that I believe that that can take place. There's a scripture, I believe it's Hebrews. I can't remember exactly where it was located. But it says, fret not or do not be upset about someone who's passing now, because God could, in essence, be taking them away for the sin or the mess they may fall into later on.
Why do God allow good people to die? Easy. He told Adam, in the day that you eat of this fruit, death was coming. So since Adam ate of that fruit and all men were in his loins, death has been coming upon this world.
A man's days are numbered at birth. And if we knew what that was, we would live like the devil until the morning of. And some of us, like doing our income tax return, we'll wait until the minute of.
If God says, you know what, this is your world and I'm gonna let you function and flow in it, it's a broken world. The evidence of that brokenness is seen, as he said, that the rain shines, the rain comes down on the just and the unjust, okay? It's appointed unto man. Everybody's going to die. We just don't know when. This is part of the brokenness of this world. We ought to be reminded of it constantly, that God can't just be in the background operating to kind of be like a master policeman to make sure that everything goes quote unquote right. Well, what's a good person? What is a good person? The scripture says, None of us is right. No, not one.
God has already put the penalty. We have already passed judgment on our flesh. And so until we are what? Forever to be with the Lord, as long as we're on this side, man in the physical shall die. It doesn't matter about good or bad, all men. But all will not die, because why? He's going to end time before all is dead.
I don't know the mind of God, why good people die. But it does say time and chance happens to us all. It is appointed unto man once to die. It doesn't matter who he is. But how that man lived his life is more important than when he dies. How you lived it.
Why are there so many different religions and denominations? Because there's so many people with egos and pride, and everybody's trying to prove their point.
First, let me take the religion part first. The religion part, and I'm glad you didn't say, why are there so many different faiths? Because we believe one Lord, one faith, one baptism, which is Christianity. Religion and the way we worship, religion is a liturgy in and of itself, but sometimes we use religion as what the term of faith. So actually you're saying, why are there so many different types of forms of faith?
Religion simply means to search. To search. Something you do regularly, but it's to search is religion. And man has religion to search for what he think he lost. Okay? That's why there's so many, because everybody got their ideas.
So we've taken the head of the church and split his church up into all these different names. We got the Apostolic Church, we got the Church of God in Christ, the Church of Christ, the Church of God. We have the Four Square Church, the Baptist Church. Look at here, I can go on and on and on and on. Seventh-day Adventist, we can go on and on. And they're all Christian foundation-based churches, but they're all different names and identify different things.
Why there are so many denominations in religions is very simple. Adam had perfect communion and fellowship with God. There was no religion. No such thing as Baptist, Pentecostal in the 4,000 different denominations that we have now in Christendom. Okay? It was a relationship with the King. The King, his son, which was his subject, but he was the son and the King. That's it. But when man fell from the grace of God and God separated himself, we became a nation without a king, without a government. Now we're void. And what do? We fill voids. We fill voids.
Ezekiel 28 and Isaiah 14, you will find Satan in his eye wheels and what he wants. And Satan wants to be worshipped. I will be like God and I will be in the Most High. And pride was found in him. He had pipes, he was beautiful. These two particular books speak of. And so Satan, in his zeal, because he's always, he said, matter of fact, in 2 Thessalonians, he said, for the man of sin, he was going to set himself over everything that called God, that he would be worshipped as God. And that's why the church will still be in a worshiping form, but worshiping the wrong God, but yet here. And that's why she will be destroyed in Revelation 17, and you understand, in 18. All right, 18. So, what you have in different religions, so the devil, he causes, when man, we believe that, now remember, Babel happened. And man what? Separated and split. And once man, the language was no longer one, because when they was one, and God looked at them, they were all crazy and fraudulent, but they were all trying to do one thing. So he separated, but he separated them all with what? In their ungodly state, following after Nimrod. So therefore, they still know sacrifice. They still know, they know of God, but now they have formed their own what? Forms of worship.
So man is trying to get back in his own way to God. That's why there are so many. Now, Tower of Babel, all men had one language, okay? And what did they do? They tried to have church. Why? They tried to build the building to go to heaven. See, they're trying to get back to the garden by building a building and making a name for themselves. God confounded the language, but they still haven't stopped their pursuit. That's why there are so many religions and so many ways and so many things. That's why.
Seventh-day Adventist, you worshiping on the wrong day. It's supposed to be on the Sabbath day, which is Saturday. That's the day we gonna have Sabbath. So forget y'all, we coming up. So they separated. The Baptist says, once saved, always saved, and you don't understand what you're talking about, so we gonna go over here. Apostolic say, you supposed to baptize in the name of Jesus, so we not going with y'all, we going over here. Church of God in Christ, Church of Christ, Church of God, you baptize in the name of in the Baptist, you baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. You don't know what you're talking about, so we going over here. So all these different separations in the body of Christ, denominations, in the body of Christ has jacked it up, because you won't even look at the word denomination. And those that do look at the word denomination still don't care, keep their denomination. That's why I'm non-denomination. But what does denomination mean? Denomo is separate. It's interpreted and defined separate. Denomo means separate. So that's separate nations. So you take a nation and separate it. Was God pleased when Solomon did not do what he asked, and then the nations were separated, and one went to the south and one went to the north? No, he wasn't happy. No, they had to bring that thing back together. The body of Christ has to come back together. We lost a lot of power in Christianity because of the separation in Christianity. So the Bible says the devil is the sower of discord among the brethren. Then the devil's come into the body, sowed discord among the brethren, and made us separate.
Man is always seen through a glass dimly. He says in Corinthians, he said, and we see through it darkly, and we don't quite have what? The quite full understanding. So somebody sees it this way. Somebody understands it this way. And And I think where we really make our mistake denominationally is we try to say who's saved and not saved.
Let's look at the Bible. Nowhere where you read all these different names. The Bible says, my house shall be called the house of prayer. That's why our church is called the house of prayer. I put ecclesiastic on the end because ecclesiastic simply means church. So it's the house of prayer church, all right? Because the churches in Corinth were identified as churches in that city. The churches in Philippi was identified as the churches in that city.
Multiple
churches in that city. The churches of Ephesus were identified as churches of that city. It wasn't a Paul's church in the city of Ephesus. It wasn't Barnabas' church in the city of Corinth. It wasn't looked at as that.
And we have to be careful because that's what happens with people. People, they have enamored themselves in their own belief because Satan has seared our conscience. And so even though we know of God by all of the things that are created, but for somehow we change God into the image of corruptible things, birds, cars, bicycles, telephones, everything we can do to make God, we do it. You know, and that's the problem. And then if I want to denounce your God, I just say your God is not, and everybody's trying to say whose God is, and everybody's going to get to practice the theory or get a chance to what? Take their theory before God and say, now here I am.
All other religions are together except the true religion. Why Satan attack Christianity and not the others? Why are we separated and the others aren't? We're the only religion that has been separated, Christianity. It's not 10,000 different Buddhist sects. It's not 10,000 different Muslim sects. It's not 10,000 different Hindu sects. It's over 10,000 different Christian religions.
I think that there is built into us innately a desire to understand where we come from. And if you don't have God, if you don't know the living God, you will naturally, I believe, create something that will help you to try and make sense of your reality. This, I believe, is where we find religion, religious practices, and various beliefs that evidence themselves in advanced cultures as well as those that are very basic. You're always going to find something because there's something built into people that draws them toward looking for a way, a mechanism, a vehicle to make sense of the their reality. The question is, who wrote the Bible? Okay, who physically penned the Bible? Obviously, it was people, individuals over time who physically penned, but it's the Spirit of God who actually authored the Bible. As the scripture says, people were moved or inspired by the Spirit of God. And they simply were mechanisms whereby the Word of God flowed through them. So the author of the Bible is God Himself. The instruments that pen the various words were people that He used to put that Bible together.
The Bible was written, inspired by about 40 different authors, which blesses my heart because if God used 40 different pens, let's say, in these authors, he used them to write it as they were his pen. It proves to me that there's a God. Why do you say that, Bishop? Watch. If man would have wrote the Bible, then the first verse would have said, God is real. Verse 2 would have said, no, he's not. We are so controversial. We're always got to outdo. We're so competitive. Man is so clashing with one another, always going against each other, we always have to outdo. And because this Bible that I read lines up verse by verse, book by book, all 66 books have to be written by one person. He just used 40 different pens. So God wrote the book. It's an inspired word from God. And he used a little over 40 different authors to write it.
You know what? I'm going to make that real simple. If you're talking to me about me, I'm going to tell you all the good stuff. You really think I'm going to tell you all the dirt I did? Now, King David, he had control over the press. See, he's not an elected official, he's a king. He has control, point blank, period. So why would David write about his sin with Bathsheba and the scandalous thing that he did with Uriah to make him look bad? Are you serious?
We have so many different translations. If you want the true understanding, you have to learn how to read Aramaic. I personally don't know how to read Aramaic. I'm still learning Greek and Hebrew, and I'm getting a lot out of the Greek and Hebrew interpretation of these words that are written now into easier English. So let's put it like this. The King James Version is written at a 12th grade reading level. That's the most popular version of the Bible that's written, the King James Version, 12th grade reading level. Sad to say, America reads at a 3rd grade reading level. So my job, your job, a leader's job, is to take that 12th grade reading level Bible and break it down into a 3rd grade so that everybody can understand it. King James had to break that Bible down into the King James Version because they too did not understand Aramaic, and it had to be widespread. He did his job. And everyone after that did their job to try and make that Bible more easier to understand as they could. The Trinity is the triune doctrine of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. God the Father came on this earth as Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. When he died and left this place, he said, "My Father will send back a comforter, which is the Holy Spirit." So God is the creator of the universe, the invisible creator of the universe. Jesus is the incarnation of God who walked this planet. John 1 says, "In the beginning was the Word was God, the Word was with God." And most folks said that the Trinity is not demonstrated in the Old Testament, but I can show it. Genesis 1:1 says, "In the beginning God created the heavens and the earth." Introduced to God, verse 1. Verse 2 said, "And the Spirit of the Lord," I believe the NIV version says, "the Spirit of the Lord hovered over the deep." Introduction, Holy Ghost. Verse 3 says, "And God said," S-A-I-D. You can't say anything without a word. John said, "In the beginning was the Word was God, and the Word was with God." So in verse 3, when God said, "Let there be light," and Jesus says in the New Testament that he is the light of the world. Verse 1 is introduction of God. Verse 2 is introduction of the Holy Spirit. And verse 3 is the introduction of Jesus. And I just showed you the Trinity in the Old Testament.
So I think we can understand it to a certain extent, but we will never be able to see it as it is. There are things in the scripture that absolutely blow my mind. I remember Jesus was one time, they asked Jesus, when is the kingdom coming? When are you gonna return? Jesus said, "That's only the Father that knows that information, not even the Son. Yet, he and the Father were one." So the Trinity is really our mechanism to try and understand various facets about our one God. And I find that when I reach the end of my understanding, it's then faith that allows me to embrace him as he is.
It says, "In beginning, Elohim." Elohim is a plural form of God that is written in a singular manner. So I am looking at it in this scripture, and this is just from the study, but I believe the basic tenets that he says when Jesus says in about the 15th or 16th, he says, "I will pray to the Father that he will send you another comforter." The word used in "another" is one just like me. See, not different, another like me. The word used, and that's what's so beautiful about the Greek, when you study it, then you can kind of get a better clarity and clear answer. So he says, "another like me." So I believe that Jesus, and he says, now he'll send the Spirit, and he said, "He shall teach you all things that I have." He will bring to your remembrance all that I have brought you. And that's the Holy Spirit. And I believe that they are in complete agreement. For it says in Acts, the second chapter, about the 21st and 22nd verse, says that it said before the foreknowledge and the God, it said predetermined counsels, God, they sat down. And so I believe that God, and they said they did counsel with themselves. So I just believe in that God, but I believe in the oneness. Now, don't give me anything. Here I say, I bow for my faith. I believe that they're one. Now, will I get to heaven and I see three gods? you know, or I get to heaven, I see one God with three heads on it. I don't know. So you just have to, I just tell you, I believe in the Trinity. I believe in the oneness. And so you go figure that out and you'll be baffled like me. But I believe in Jehovah. I believe in Jesus and I believe in the Holy Spirit. Now, how you want to portray them, that's on you. I'll tell you, the Trinity is a hard one to explain. I love them.
Well, you have pretty much the God the Father, which is the first person of the Godhead, which you don't read that nowhere in Scripture. First person of the Godhead? Okay, anyway. God the Son and God the Holy Spirit. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, three in one, coexisting, moving all together, three in one. I have a problem with that.
But the bottom line is, the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost is come against by some different denominations, saying that the Trinity's not even in the Bible, the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost are not three different people, and then you get into doctrinal differences, and the war begins, and the fight erupts, blah, blah, blah. The bottom line is this, brother, the Father created the universe, Jesus, the Holy Spirit, is one, and certain denominations say, yeah, there are one, why do you keep splitting them up? I know some people say, how could it take three gods to beat up one devil? In my opinion, it's not three gods beating up three devils. It's one devil. It's everything has its opposite. God, Satan. Jesus Christ, the Antichrist. The Holy Spirit, the false prophet. Everything has its opposite. So if you look at it like that, you can start seeing it in a different manner. But I'm just giving out these facts. You make your own assumptions. But the bottom line, that's who the Trinity is. That's what the Trinity is all about. And that's the answer to the question.
Once saved, always saved. I believe that once saved, always saved is an excellent doctrine. I don't see it written that way in the Bible. Yet I can believe that once I've given my life to Christ, no one can take me out of his hand. Yet I understand also that he talks about in the scripture, the person that walks away from God. Just as we can decide as an act of our free will and faith to embrace God as Lord of our life, you can walk away from God. What will the penalty be for that? I'm not so comfortable as to say that I could step all over God, act like a complete fool, decide to reject the blood of Christ, and that I'm always in. So I think once saved, always saved is an excellent doctrine that will certainly apply that as long as you want to be saved, as long as you want to walk with Christ, nobody can take you out of his hands.
If I'm paying you $100,000 a year to work for me, you better not be late. If you're late, you're gonna come and talk to me, and I will decide if I forgive you. And your coworkers has nothing to do with it. We understand that. We understand you could be paying $7 an hour at the car wash. They hired you, you met the requirements, you have a uniform, but you don't come to work. And when you come to work, you don't work. How long will you be an employee? Now, if we can understand that, why are we imposing a lazy, non-committed attitude to God? See what I'm saying? That's religion. Because we're lazy. We don't want to be committed, but we want all the benefits of being obedient. I'm sorry. It don't work that way.
Who are we to judge another man's servant? So when I say one say, that's something between who? I can shake your hand and tell you I'm saved, but I may not be saved with God. And that's why I gave you St. Luke and the 7th chapter and Matthew the 13th. For that's the time when it talks about people in the house who are not saved, but they're in the house. See what I'm saying? Because I healed, I did this in your name. I healed in your name. Man, I was at church every Sunday. Never got saved. I heard one man explain, I understood it. He said, I didn't get saved till I got old. I've been preaching, but I didn't get saved.
You normally find that in the Baptist denomination of Christianity.
Once saved, always saved.
Once saved, always saved. I understand it to be a yes, and I understand it to be a no, depending on how you look at it. Let me try to explain it the best I can. I believe this scripture is in Hebrews, and I'm going to paraphrase it. It says something like, once you have tasted of the goodness of God, you can never go back. So with that being true, once saved, you're always saved. So believing that, if you ever go back, the question is, was you ever saved? So I believe from that standpoint, it does stand true. But being in the society we're in, seeing the realization of life, no. Some folks say they saved and they this and they that, and next thing you know, they're going opposite direction.
So can you fall out being saved?
Yes, you can be saved. In
you
other
be
words,
saved and no longer.
Yeah, you can be saved and now you're on your way. You can be on your way to the kingdom of heaven, and then all of a sudden you're on your way to hell. Yes, you can be. Which means I'm going to see Jesus. I'm living my life the way God wants me to do. Then I turn around and say, I'm sick of this. I'm sick of people in the church. They just say, pick up a gun and start busting people and blowing their heads off. How am I going to make it into the kingdom? So how could I be saved? Once saved, always saved. In other words, I can't backslide. The word backslide is in the word. So if I can't backslide, if I can backslide, then how could I be once saved, always saved? But then all of a sudden you have the scripture where God says, He will save whom He will save. So I can't say who's going to heaven and who's not. He said, I'll save whom I will save. He said, I make vessels unto honor and vessels unto dishonor. He has it. I tease the church a lot and say, don't be surprised, you might see Pharaoh in heaven.
So that's my position. I believe that once you're saved, you are saved. But I believe you can turn your back on Christ just as you accepted Him. And woe to the person who has banked their salvation on a doctrine, bank their relationship with Christ, and signs up and finds out that God said, you know what? That's not what I meant, pal. See ya. I think that'd be rough.
Everybody that come to church not filled with the Holy Ghost. Everybody that proclaim to be saved are not all saved. So once saved, always saved? Nah. Appear to be saved, saved? Nah. Telling me you saved, saved? Nah. Holding the Bible, saying you saved, speaking in tongues, saved. Nah, I just gotta watch your life to make sure you're saved. Period.
The parable of the virgins, the wheat and the tares. What is that telling you? They look alike, but ain't everybody ready? The virgins was all in the same place at the same time, but the same, 50% didn't make it. You can tell yourself, God gonna make me in anyway, but go to the border without the toll and see if you're gonna get through. All right, that's it.
Was Jesus black? I don't know what color he was.
These black folks need to take a lesson, because he loves and he gives, and black folks are stingy.
How can he be black?
It can't be impossible for him to be black the way we act.
Well, I wouldn't say he was black, though. I have some pro-black people that want to fight me because they were from the Egyptian era or the African era of the continent. I would tell you that they were dark-complected people. Would I say they were black? No, he was a Jew. Jews were darker-complected than Europe or white people. I can't necessarily say he was black, but I will tell you this, he was holy, and that's all I care about.
I see no evidence that he was black. If he came from the Middle East, he had a Middle Eastern appearance. But then again, I've had people ask me, how can you worship Jesus, quote unquote, who's white? Again, I don't necessarily put my arms around those ideas either, that they drew him with blue eyes. Really, the color that really matters to me is red, the color of his blood.
He was holy. He died for me. I don't care if he was blue, orange, or purple. He died on the cross and took my sins. He could have been psychedelic and plaid. I don't care. That's what he did. And if I really want to ask him his true color, I wait till I see him. Because I know I'm black, and there's a whole lot of other different nationalities on this planet, and my job is to save every single one of them. And I don't care if they're black, white, Chinese, Mexican, African, dirty knees, don't care to me. I want them saved.
He could be any color he want to be. That's why we don't have a picture.
The point is, if the man was Chinese eating Foo Young with chopsticks, if he can heal my body and deliver me from sin, my brother, why are you debating that other man, the color of Jesus? Can you stop smoking cigarettes? Can you stop committing adultery? Can you put down the alcohol bottle? Can you stop smoking that joint? Oh, let's touch the toes a little bit. ISIS is in the body, getting us diverted from the priority of God.
Now, at the end of the day, if a person is willing to give their life for you, die in your place, would you ask him, well, you know what, I'm not going to take that because your eyes are not the right color and you're not a black man, so you can't die for me. No, let me tell you something. When you need to get saved, you don't care who it is. But no, I don't think that Jesus was an African in this sense of the word, an African American, someone of my particular hue. But he's also not the blonde, blue-haired guy that you see represented, you know, in European art. Doesn't matter. The only thing I care about is the blood that he shed for me. That's it. Is there a difference between worldly judging and being judged by God? Okay, so I love this particular fact that lots of worldly people are quick to say, you shouldn't judge, okay? Now watch this. Judgment, unrighteous judgment in the human sense of the word, is looking at and evaluating a person's worth or what's going on inside of them as though you are God and can know what's in their heart. It's not saying the sun is not shining when in fact it's shining.
Yeah, there's a big difference. Because the Bible tells us not to judge. So we don't. But if you look like a duck.
The main word that we are saying don't judge, and when it says don't judge, it uses crino. Crino is to damn or to condemn. But to judge and make righteous assessments of a certain situation, that's a different kind of judging. See, that's why I say, that's just like I love going from agape love to phileo love to sterge love to eros love, eros. You see what I'm saying? So you have those four words to put on different places. And so you have different judge. And so God, the same judgment, God says don't condemn nobody because you don't have a heaven to put them in or a hell to put them in. You can't judge in that assessment. But if you steal my car, you are what? A car thief.
God is able to look at and judge the intents of the heart and mind. He knows the motivations of individuals purely. But we as people have absolutely no place trying to put ourselves in the position of doing what God can do because we don't have the capabilities. However, that does not extend to the idea that if you see a person jumping off a building, you can't judge to say whether that's right or wrong. You know it's wrong because they're hitting the ground. Okay, but people try to say, don't judge me. What they're saying is, don't call me to accountability for what God says is right or wrong. And that I reject completely, period.
If you are doing something that is wrong, and I know it's wrong, and I tell you it's wrong, then, you know, I say, hey, you know, now I don't see two homosexuals telling each other it's wrong, but I don't see two, most people who are, whatever any people are doing, they're doing wrong, be it lying, joking, court jesting, because I'm like this, I don't try to make sexual acts the only sin.
But what we're not supposed to do is to look at people and judge them as though we can understand them internally and what's in their heart and what motivates them. Now, there's your answer, because only God can do that.
I'm not talking about sexual sin, all sin, if it's fornication, adultery, whatever it is, or if it's lying, if it's backbiting, gossiping, All of them are sins. So we call you away from what? Sin. We call you away from sin, not necessarily your life. We call you away from sin. Sin is to be what? Against God. Now, if I tell you you're doing something that God's word said let's not do, then that's, I'm not trying to judge you. I'm just trying to inform you to live what? Holy and a better life.
Why do people think that they can sin willfully and still get into heaven? That's an interesting question. I'm not sure people think that they can sin willfully. I think they can sin and get away with it and get into heaven.
Oh, because they don't have a relationship with God. The true relationship with God will reveal to you that I can't live my life the way I want to. I got to live it the way He desires me to live it. And once I start living the way God wants me to, when I deviate from that and step out of the will of God, it'll bother me. It'll convict me, which makes me line myself back up, which means I'm not going to practice this thing. I'm not going to practice it. But you will find yourself in the midst of sin, not by practice. It just happened. Something you didn't pay attention to, lost your focus. You find yourself in the midst. Oh, Lord, how did I end up here? Oh, Lord, please forgive me. I'm so sorry. I know I shouldn't be doing nothing like this. You get up out of it and you leave it alone.
Now, I have to tell you, I personally cannot understand or calculate God's level of forgiveness. But I know that it is a lot broader and deeper than my own. Okay? Moses willfully killed the Egyptian. David willfully. Nobody told him to go beyond the eye problem. He had to go through a mechanism of different steps to say, yo, go and get that girl, bring her over here, bring her to my room, and I'm gonna get with her. He did that willfully, yet God forgave him. Paul willfully got letters to persecute the church and had folk dragged out willfully. But God still forgave him, cleansed him, and they'll be in heaven. So I don't know at what particular point that God decides, you know what? You crossed the line.
So yeah, they think they can willfully sin because they have imposed their standard of justice.
Their standard of righteousness.
Their standard of justice. Their standard of righteousness, and they have taken that because it's real to them and say, okay, God, that's how you think. It doesn't work like that.
The Bible says that there's a sin that's not unto death, but then there's a sin that is unto death. So let's look at it. A murder. If you kill somebody just by accident, or you kill somebody in self-defense, that's manslaughter. But if you plot and scheme, set it up, know it's coming, and you kill somebody, that's first degree murder. So the penalty of first degree murder is the electric chair, the death penalty for that, because you planned it and you made it happen. We have a lot of people who are saved planning their sin. They know it's coming, they know they're gonna do it, and they do it. So to plan it is sin in the first degree, and the penalty is death, because the wages of sin is death. So we cannot willfully plan first degree sin and expect to get away with it. We're gonna deal with the consequences.
But I believe that his ability to forgive even willful sins is a function of his grace, which is beyond our ability to understand. The danger, I believe, is in presuming that you can continue to push that envelope. And I think that's where people fall into problems. They think, you know, there's never a cost. The cost may not be salvific in nature, but it can certainly be chastisement and correction. Your parents continue to be your parents, continue to love you when you're a kid. You willfully disobey, they will willfully apply a discipline, but that doesn't mean that they reject you as their children. And I think we need to keep that model in line.
Sin is definitely all against God. Sometimes we use fancy words and call it self-inflicted nonsense. S-I-N for the acronym, SIN. Self-inflicted nonsense. But really it is when we are doing that which is opposed to what God would want us to do.
Okay, what is sin, and does all sin lead you to hell? It's a couple different things. Sin is falling short of God's standard. It's not meeting the level that God has said as this is the mark. So everything that misses the mark is sin.
So sin is like having your weapon at the range and you have 20 shots and you don't hit the bullseye on every shot. You miss the mark. That's what sin means, to miss the mark. Now, if you have consistently missed the mark, you're a no-go. You don't pass. You fail.
All saints, contrary, now I don't believe that a saint is a sinner. No. A saint is a saint. A sinner, a saint once was a sinner. But a saint is not a sinner. A saint, though, may sin. So all sin cannot qualify that. Now, once he's saved, otherwise, because God cleans up the sins of the sinner, or Jesus cleaned up the sins of the sinner at the cross. But now he's making intercessors for us, so he's cleaning up the sins in heaven now. So we have to be careful and realize that God is Christ is making intercessors for the saints. That tells me that he's not only helping me get things done, but he also has to cover me.
All sin leads you to hell, period. You're born in sin, and you're born with a first-class ticket to hell. That seems strange that a person would say, well, you know, why is a little sin could take me to hell just as fast as a big sin does? Because all sin falls short, and only perfection, the perfection of Christ, can get a person into heaven.
But if you hit the mark and you missed it sometime, then that's where grace comes in and covers you. Because you're trying to hit the mark, but you miss. It's okay. Grace covers. God is not saying, okay, zap, you go to hell right there. But let me tell you something. Sin is sin. Unrepented sin, if you're cheating on your wife or you're lying on your income taxes, unrepented sin does not make it into the kingdom of God. And God is not going to be like a lint collector and picking out little, okay, this is okay, this is okay, this is okay. No. He said he's coming back for a church without spot, wrinkle, or any such thing. You better get it right.
And man is always found in opposition to God because he has fallen, he has taken the hand of Satan. And Christ comes and we broke the word. We broke his word. He said, don't do this, and we broke it. So we did that. Then God came down as the word and repaired the word, kept all of the word that he might save some of us. But sin leads to hell if one is not saved, though.
And if you can't get it right, ask for help. And don't act like you don't know if you're doing wrong. You know if what you're doing is wrong, whether or not you can find the chapter and verse in the Bible or not. And don't sit there and say, well, God, you know, and debate little sin and big sin, because you're covering your own dirt. And any sin that's covered, don't make it into the kingdom. So, there's no big and little in the eyes of God. Unrepented sin gets the same punishment. Confess sin, there is forgiveness. And just because you don't think it's a problem, don't mean it's not a problem.
If you're unsaved, yes, all your sin is leading you to hell. Because remember now, you're already unsaved. So it doesn't matter. Your condition is already headed toward hell. But God has a way of escape if you choose. And then once you choose, then I guess that gets back to the thing where we said, once saved and always saved and fully saved. Like I said, if you truly get saved, I believe you're in the hands of God and Christ. He said, no man. And I believe I'm a man. I can't pluck myself out if God saved me. I said, if God saved me, I can't save me. God has to save me. is truly the work of God. That's why salvation was truly the work of Christ. So we have to understand that. Why are so many homosexuals going against the marriage that God established? That question goes to the heart of man's situation, which is sin. Man sins. And sin is what? Going against what God has established.
Because that's one of the rules they decided to vote out of the Constitution of Heaven. The Romans clearly says they refused to retain the knowledge of God. So it is a willful, active, progressive disobedience. And God says, okay, I'm going to turn you over. So they think it's okay because we haven't read of the ground opening up, swallowing a bunch of people lately. So because God is not slapping people with leprosy, because God is not giving people cancer, because, you know, if God is so big and bad, why don't he strike me down right now? And then they fall dead.
If I'm doing wrong.
If this is wrong, how come God, you know, stuff, they say so silly stuff.
Here's something that people may not be comfortable with. Homosexuality is a sin just like every other sin. It would be the exact same answer. If God gave us the law to protect us, why do people go against the law? Right? It's simply a function of our brokenness. Whether it's homosexuality, bestiality, adultery. Think about it. He made a marriage so that we could invest our desires in one another, and people go against it. People go against what God has planned because we're broken. Homosexuality is no different in that respect. It's just another evidence of our rebelliousness. And there are many different features and characteristics. One's sexual preference or choice, which is different than God's design, is just one manifestation of that.
That's practiced sin. So wrong is wrong, right is right. And when the wrong is so tempting and attractive and desirable to me, then I must justify any means possible to get it. There's no justification in the will of God. It's black or white. You're right or wrong. And we, as people, to stay in our practice sin will justify why we're there. And a lot of homosexuals, I believe, and I'm not homosexual, so I can't say I fully understand it or know it, but I mean, say I'm born this way, or a man don't know how to please me, or a woman, the lesbian, to say a woman don't know how to please me, and all these different excuses or justification on why they do what they do. But if I'm married and I cheat, or I go out my marriage and I sleep with someone else, then I'm going to hell for that, or I'm going to be, I should be convicted if I'm saved, or I got to deal with the consequences of that, just like they have to deal with the consequences of same-sex relationship, because both sides, though I'm heterosexual and I'm dealing with a woman, but I still stepped out of my marriage, I stepped out the will of God, and they stepped out the will of God, so we're both giving in to our sexual desires. So giving in to our sexual desires means there's consequences that we have to deal with.
So. If you ask him why sinful men do sinful things, it's because he's a sinner, you know what I'm saying? And he needs what? He needs the power of the Holy Spirit in order to what? Guide his action. For it's not in a man, Jeremiah says, in order to guide himself. For a man cannot direct his steps, you know. So we must, you know, and so I tell everybody, all sin is missing the mark. Now, abomination, we know that's terrible. That's like not just missing the mark. That's going a whole against God. But it's still sinful man. So that's why they are doing what they're doing. It's not that they're doing anything different than any sinner.
I would marry a gay couple, a lesbian couple, and let me tell you why. If they would do everything that a normal couple would do, I would marry them. But what would a normal couple do? First thing they would have to do is go through premarital counseling. And they'd have to go through prayer and premarital counseling. Now, if they make it through the prayer and the premarital counseling, I will marry them. Now, I don't know how long the prayer and the premarital counseling might take. But if they survived it, I would marry them. And there's no way in the world they're going to be able to survive it. Not in that situation.
I'll marry them. But see, the bylaws of my church says that every married couple has to go through counseling, that I determine the parameters and the length thereof. And you can't have sex. You want to be gay? Okay, say you want to be gay. Fornication is still a sin. You don't have carte blanche, so you can't have sex.
Okay, very simply, I'm given simply biblical authority. So I can't say, as the scripture commands, I can't do it. Very simple. So no, I would not do a homosexual wedding, but there are some heterosexual weddings that I don't do as well. Oh yeah. Not everybody that comes into my office gets a nod that I'll sign off on the certificate, because there are some things that, again, I believe are against God's word. Unequally yoked is a challenge in some instances. If I know that there's going to be a problem, or a total disrespect of marriage and it's a sham, I won't be a part of that either. So for me, it's not a question of whether I would, I simply can't. That's my answer.
Said to Adam, by the sweat of your brow shall the ground give up its strength. And the woman said, what? That she would be saved in childbearing. She would be in labor. So we know that in the seed of the woman, you know, which we know does not carry a woman, was prophetic, but it was talking about birthing. So we understand that God has set the parameters. He said, God makes the statement, not men. He says, for what? A man should be the head of the house. It didn't say what kind of man. It just said man should be the head of the house. And that, you know, I'm not saying that women aren't stronger, aren't wiser than some of their husbands, and surely they are, but he's still the man. And so we have to accept the rules that God has set. And so I cannot marry one based on the fact that he says man, he said, and a woman, because he says, well, let everyone be the husband of one wife, okay? And that's Christian. He's talking about especially those Christians, because at that time, Christians were marrying everybody for the sake, it was new, for that was the thing what Gentiles had. And we know that, so God had to re-stipulate, this is my cause. And but he's saying, husband of one wife, okay? So that's man and woman. So that's my theory. I cannot marry you based on my Bible. Now the state, they can do whatever they want to do because the state is not saved. See? And so they can continue to practice that unsaved tradition that they have started. And what they call it, they call it some civil marriages. See? Civil marriage. And so, in other words, they're saying it's not based on God. Even though, God, if you're not saved, if you're not believing in God, I don't see what's the purpose of getting married when you can just live together and shack up. Why don't you just go on and live sinfully? You know, but it's their choice to the civil anyway.
Why did Jesus drink wine, or did he? He drank wine the same reason that he ate a piece of meat or had a loaf of bread. Wine is nothing more than a food, period. And that's the answer, period.
I do know that Jesus didn't get drunk, and the Bible speaks against alcoholism. So because the Bible speaks against alcoholism and God is one, I can logically say Jesus didn't do what other people were doing. Because it'd go against a lot of the scriptures, and the Bible doesn't go against each other.
Wine was better than water back then. You know, even Paul told Timothy, he said, well, drink a little wine for your stomach. He said, I think we put a lot on the wine and the grapes, because Israel was a grape nation. They made it, and so they had it. It was medicinal, you know, but you know, most medicinal came from the olive, though. I'm not gonna, because that was a bummer, but different herbs. But you know, it has its alcoholic properties for disinfecting and doing different things. So he just drank wine because that's what they drank. I'm not gonna put no more than it was cultural. It's cultural for the Jews, and you go to a Jewish kabod now.
I don't know what the worst sin is, but I do recall in the scripture that Jesus said this, that there's one sin that man will not be forgiven for, and that is blaspheming the Holy Ghost. Obviously, there's some things where God says, you know what? No, you know, man, that's it. You crossed the line. No mulligans. The Holy Ghost is off limits, Jack. You go down that, you open up that door, you're done, period. Which was, you know, it's fascinating because that answer seemed to have come out of nowhere. But Jesus was saying, you know, all manner of sins will be forgiven men, except blasphemy, because they were saying bad things about him, and that he was casting out devils by the power of being a devil. And he's like, you know what? You don't know, you know what? You don't know what you're talking about, Jack, but I'm going to tell you right now, you're about to go down that path where if you open your stupid mouth, you're done. That's my answer to that question.
Well, you know what? I tell you what, the worst sin to have to deal with, though, is he that soweth discord. And that is a very, very, very tragic sin in the church, and the gossip. You know, once the discord gets going, everybody tends to jump in and participate. And we can really become ravenous about an issue. You know, if we think, and a lot of times we get on stuff, and we say, I heard you used to be say, well, if saints are talking about it, it's probably true. But they talk about a lot of things that's not true. They just like to talk, because gossiping is one of our mouth. So we have our worst sins, for even James said, and I have to go back to the Bible, said, well, who can control this tongue of ours? And that's, so I think, we commit our worst sins, you know, because we kill power, life, and death as in the tongue. We prophesy negatively over people, or we bring destruction to people, or ruin, hurt to them with our mouth. And that's the worst sin. Don't get me wrong. We know that there's abominations. But he soweth discord. He said, 16 the Lord hath, 17 is abomination. He that soweth discord. So, but then we know that homosexual. So, the rankings of them, I'll leave that with God, but I'll tell you that if it's one that really, because I don't have homosexuals in the church, I mean, I don't know, anybody could be undercover, but I don't know, but when you hear that gossip, or when you hear somebody coming to you and crying because somebody said something, that is the one thing you deal with the most. Is smoking weed a sin? Is it legal? It's legal.
But remember, different states have.
That's what I say. So now we get into an area that is, I'll put it like this. This preacher would not go on record. This preacher's not going to go on record about anything he used to do.
right.
But I will say this. You're right. You have cultures. I know that. I mean, you have Jamaican cultures that do it. So, I mean, it's an herb. And so, I think the Indians did it. So, I don't know.
That's a tough one.
You know, when you say sin, we have things that man once had prohibition against what? Alcohol.
Yeah.
Smoking weed is a sin because it breaks the law of man. Now, you might say, well, what happens when they change the laws and say, you know, you can smoke weed, then I think it's gonna be questionable. Here's what the bigger issue is. What's behind, because I'm assuming that we're talking about Christians. Now you're a Christian, obviously you shouldn't be smoking marijuana. They changed the law, and all of a sudden, you know, hey, can I go get fired up now? The question is, what is behind that decision? Are you looking to tie into something rather than tying into Christ? And I can tell you personally, as a person who went to college, was unsaved, knows about marijuana firsthand, that you know, that's the kind of thing where you're looking for something in your life. Now, I got Christ. I got all the high that I need. So the question would be, what would I need to explore going down the path of marijuana or any kind of other stimulant when I've got Jesus as part of my life?
I'm going to answer that with one word. Yes.
No further answers.
Anything that you willfully alter your state of consciousness.
Messing with the temple.
All right. Now don't nobody write me and say, what about the doctor? Because see, you're saying, you know better than a doctor's prescription for something and you wanting to smoke weed because you feel it's good for you because your state says it's okay. You know the difference. People know the difference. That's why they argue it so much.
I'm gonna obey the laws of the land. And right now, I know if you're in Colorado, then the law, you're straight, you know.
If that's what you're doing.
Yeah, that's what you're doing. You know, so, I mean, because that's, you know, but I don't never want to be found. I would never tell nobody to go out and break the law.
Now, a person could say, well, you know what? What about wine and beer? Again, wine and beer fall into a different category. When you have a glass of wine, are you having it to get rocked? Now we have a problem. Are you drinking beer because you like the taste of the hops, like to just relax a little bit, or are you trying to get buzzed? It's always back to where your heart is, what you're doing. God sees it and he knows. So a beer for somebody might be no problem. But the other guy, you're trying to get rocked, God knows it. Same thing for wine or any other kind of alcoholic beverage. I know I stepped on some folks' toes right then, but too bad.
I say that most people, because of the historical factness of Jesus, which is proven by some of the Jewish historians in antiquity, Josephus and Philo, you can prove his humanity. But we believe in his godly, it's called the hypostatic union. We believe that he was fully God and he was fully man, and that in him was two natures, that God had what come, and we see in Adam we see man made in the image of God, but in Jesus we see God made in the image of man. And for that we have to believe that there is a thing called salvation. And so I try to get people, if I'm really trying to get you to believe in Jesus, I'm trying to get you to believe in his divinity. You know, you may can believe that he's a man, but can you believe that there was a penalty to be paid, and that penalty was so high that only God could pay it for himself? Can you believe that God would pay? It's as if me owing you $1 million and you come and put $1 million in my pocket and then tell me to pay you. That's what God has done for us. And so I'm trying to get you to believe, but I have to get you to believe that you lost first. If I can't get you to believe that there's no lostness in you, that you have been alienated from God, that you are a stranger, a foreigner, as the Bible say, if you can't believe that, then I can't really get you saved, because I can't get you to believe in Jesus. I can get you to believe in his physicalness, you know. Because you're going to say to me, well, people have been dying every year. Yeah, people have been dying because God is long-suffering and God has a plan. He said, for when the fullness of the Gentile comes in Romans 11:25, he said, there is a number that will get saved and time will start to end, because God is going to deal no longer with the Gentile, but go back to Israel. And then that's when we have this thing called the 7 years. We start getting into another of our end-time prophecy. And you start dealing with, God start dealing with Israel again, that he may bring her fully in, because he has made her jealous by the church. But she's still what? His chosen people. But that does not annul. We are grafted in. Surely we got to realize that God has not cast off Israel. So getting you to see that Jesus is a man may not be difficult. Getting you to see that Jesus has paid the sin and has died and has raised again and sit now on the right hand of the Father, that's the task at hand.
First of all, you probably are never going to see Jesus personally. And the idea of Jesus is really something that defies logic. The way that you come to know Jesus is actually because of your own faith and the reality of what he does to change you, which is completely opposite of your personal best interests. Think about it. You place your faith in a person that you realize died for your sins in your place, and you take him and make him the priority of your life, which is something that you can't do on your own. The fact that you have the faith to believe in Jesus, that he gives you the ability to do that, is evidence of him being real. You have to think about that for a moment. I know Jesus is real because I'm able to believe in him in a way that changes what is my natural inclination, which is to put myself first, to put my feelings first, my desires first. Only a real God could actually change the way that you are wired, so your faith is evidence of his reality, that he's real. I want people to know that's how you know Jesus is real, because of your own faith in him.
Yes, Jesus is real. It's documented. We got the scriptures, the documents, the life of Christ. Historians in the book of Josephus, it's documented who Jesus was. So he is yet real. The question, is he the Son of God? Is he the walking word? Is he God incarnate? And yes, he is. But I will say this, when Jesus was walking, he walked as a man, as an example for us on what to do, how to live, how to do this thing. He prayed. He empowered himself through prayer to do amazing things, showing us what to do. We could not follow Jesus or mimic Jesus if he was man and God at the same time in its entirety. If he had all the power of heaven in him, unlike we have, we pray it, we receive it in that manner. He did it exactly the way we're supposed to do it, then we couldn't follow him, because Jesus had the power to ascend and go up into the sky. And if we're supposed to follow him step by step, I can't take a step and walk on the air and go. But I can pray and I can receive the power that he received and do the things that he do, because we are to do greater things than he did. So he is definitely real. I mean, his blood was shed. His physicality is there. He was brutally beaten. His physicality, it was a crown of thorns put on his head. They put a sign on it, the King of the Jews. It's all documented. Jesus was real. Was he the Son of God? Yes, he was. Because once you've documented that it was him, as even as the scriptures say, and then the documents show that he walked on water. You can't document one part and say the other part's a lie. He walked on water. He turned water into wine. He healed the sick. He made the blind to see. He's done so many great feats. He brought the dead back to life. So if you document one, you got to document it all. It's all documented. This is all written, recorded. So yes, Jesus was real. And with all the miracles he performed them with the power of God. The evidence of God's power in him is evidence that there is a God. And because there is a God, I believe in him, I walk with him, and I live by it. In the mighty name of Jesus. A to the me.
Israel is the most talked about and most discussed nation on this earth, even in modern times, concerning all kingdoms. Because why? God said that I will make it a trembling, a cup of trembling in the hands of all of those that will concern themselves with it. Therefore, that makes the Bible one of the most accurate and most imaginative books to ever be written, because it's not written of man, but it's inspired by God. And so Jesus, and I do believe that God could and would look on the faults and the frailties of his creation and devise his own scheme and his own plan to save that creation for himself. Yes, now would I have died on the cross? You're right. No, I wouldn't have died on the cross. I wouldn't have thought to do that. I wouldn't have thought to go be whipped all night long. I wouldn't have thought of that. I wouldn't have thought to be born in a virgin and to be in a manger. I would have come down at this particular time. I'd have had a limousine ride to Cedar Sinai. I would have been born in the best maternity ward in the Americas. And then my home would have been lavish. It would have already been there. But no, only God could himself could say to come to give up all his glory in heaven and to come and just be a simple man, but not and live simple with a great and enormous task. And that is a scheme that he had devised. For it says, by the predetermined knowledge and the four counsels of God, he had us to deliver him up for death. Would I have thought to die to rescue man? I wouldn't have thought of that. That's why this scheme is even too great to be imagined by man. For no man could have thought of this scheme, because no man would have thought of it this way. Not like this. And that makes it so, in itself, divinely inspired, so utter unrealistic to believe that someone would even go that far just to save a wretch like me. Jesus Christ is true in my life. I pray that he will move from mystical into your life and move to reality, for there is a reality in serving a true and a living God. Amen.
Yes, he is real. And I know he's real because the Bible says so. Well, there's a lot of atheists in the world, and a lot of people denounce God himself. But there's a lot of religions that acknowledge Jesus. They just acknowledge him as something other than what he said he was. And I know he is real. History says he is real. The Bible says he's real. Historians and theologians say he's real. He was born. He was born of a virgin and his mother Mary. And we can read that. You don't have to have faith in that because it is actually tangible. Jesus' existence is tangible. Now, who he said he was and the things he did, is that tangible? Jesus is real because it's documented. The things he has done is where the question comes in.
Mm. Yes, Jesus is very real. I know he's real, number one, because history proves it. I mean, history, like, you go to school and learn history. History proved that Jesus walked the earth. So I don't doubt that.
Jesus is real, as I said, in antiquity. We can prove his, you know, thank God for archaeologists. They have, you know, done great exculpatory work. We thank him, and we thank God for historians who have what? Who make it their point to write down history. You know, God, God is smarter than us. So he's put things in place that he can prove everything. You can go back and prove all these different nations, even nations that no longer exist. You want to prove Sodom and Gomorrah, we can prove those things. You can prove the Syrian Nineveh. You can prove that. You know, we can prove that Jesus, you know, the estuary, we found James' estuary, you know, Joseph's estuary. We found those different little tomb plates that they would have for them, crypts. So we can prove the antiquity of Jesus' existence.
Jesus is absolutely real. Now, of course, there's a number of different ways if I were not a prosecutor, but I'm the defense attorney for Jesus. You're going to point to the reality of his word, okay? His word, and you look at his word and how he affected people. He had people doing things that did not make sense. Peter, before he came into contact with the resurrected Christ, when trouble came down, he was out of there. But when he came into contact with the resurrected Christ, it transformed him in a way that he wasn't running, covering his backside. He was willing to be crucified upside down. These other guys were willing to be torn apart, drawn and quartered, beheaded. Jesus is real. 500 people saw him. They saw him after he rose from the grave. And that impactful encounter changed them in a way that lets me know 2,000 years ago, look, what I know about people is that people aren't sticking their neck out for nobody. They're not. They're always going to put themselves first. But they encountered Jesus as God, and that encounter changed them.
We can go back and forth with different religions on who they say he is. None of it adds up. You can research any religion you want to, trace it to its origin, and you will end up in the Bible. So the Bible holds its own. This inspired word of truth that was written by over 40 different authors is tangible proof to me on who Jesus is. So the Bible says so. I believe it in my heart. I see it for myself. I feel it. I know it. The Spirit of God that dwells on the inside confirms it. And I thank the Lord for that.
For me to doubt that Jesus walked the earth is for me to doubt that there were settlers in this country when this country was settled. It makes me doubt that there were ever any Indians. I wasn't there, right? How do I know King Henry VIII actually lived? Because of record and evidence. Same applies to Jesus. That's why I know he's real. And then there are things that happen in my life that cannot be explained unless God was with me. So there's faith and there's history. So I know he's real, no doubt.
So the scriptures speak of it. When I look at the scriptural documentation, I know that Jesus is real. When I look at the Old Testament and I see how the scriptures speak to and point to him, I know that he's real. When I look at how he changed lives as evidence in the New Testament, I know how he's real. And then that third, because I like that one for the Father, one for the Son, one for the Holy Spirit, is my own personal experience with him. I lay my faith and I hook my faith on those three elements that will let me know, I can tell you, that Jesus is absolutely real.
So who is Jesus? And how do you get to know him? Come to him as a king. Prostrate your face and surrender all of your teaching, all of your thoughts, all of your presuppositions, everything your mama told you, your great grandmama told you, and look at the Bible as in a fresh pair of eyes. In that state of mind, you will see Jesus for who he is.
I haven't seen him, but he is absolutely no myth. His reality evidences itself in the fact that I'm not living in the way that I would like to live. And I've actually encountered something that has the power to transform me in spite of my desire to live like a rebel. When you've encountered that changing power, then you know your faith is real. And I know that what I believe in the Lord in whom I believe has the ability to accomplish his purpose and his plan in my life, which is the love of Christ, evidence the grace of God to bring me to a place and to bring me into a reality that is beyond this world that I'm absolutely living now, but am simply a guest of. I know that God is real. I know that Jesus existed and that he's coming again. I know it just as surely as I know that I'm sitting on this chair and speaking to this camera. He is not a myth. He's absolutely real.
Jesus said, search the scriptures, okay? This is not Pop-Tarts put in the oven. He said, search it, seek me out. And he's gonna give you all the answers that you need.
He's a lily of the valley, a bright and a morning star. He's a rose of Sharon. Well, I don't know about you, but I come in here to tell somebody about Jesus that came from down through 42 generations. Born to a virgin named Mary. See, the cross is gonna say, if you don't believe that he died, you see, you gotta believe that. See, that's where we nail that, we nail it home, that sermon. And it may, and the clothes may not even fit the sermon. But the clothes is the sermon for us missionary.